You know, I just decided something, and maybe, I don't, I guess I've always decided it, but I just decided some time ago, I was talking to my wife. And now understand, this can sound just like a brash statement. I mean, what I'm saying is you'll hear people say things like this, and they have the wrong spirit behind it. Understand what I mean by this. You remember when David brought the Ark of the Covenant into Jerusalem? And, you know, very often people say, you know, David danced naked. Well, David didn't dance naked. I mean, he had his undergarment on. He danced out of his kingly robes. All right? In other words, God gets all the glory. The king isn't getting the glory here. God's getting the glory. But he danced all the way to Jerusalem. He'd make a sacrifice and dance, and sacrifice and dance. And he got back to Jerusalem, and he was blessing all the people. And it says he went home to bless his family. And there's Saul's daughter, Michal. And she said, "Isn't this a lovely thing? The king of Israel uncovering himself in front of the handmaidens." And David made a statement, and you've heard it preached on, and it can be preached in the wrong spirit. He said, listen, if you think, and the King James uses the word vile, if you think I've been vile so far, just wait. I'm going to be more vile thus. What that means, if you think that I've been outlandish so far, I'm going to be even more outlandish. I told my wife the other day, "Baby, I'm letting it all go. We got to see this. We got to see what God wants to do. You understand? Now, why is that important? Because the Holy Spirit, listen, the Holy Spirit can do more in 5 minutes of his focused operation than we can do in 3 hours of service. Now, we'll always have the word and different things, but I'm trying to explain to you that we've got to be willing. Listen, I grew up team roping, and there's something that I learned, and it's this. There comes a time you got to give that horse his head. If you're going to catch the steer, you got to give the horse his head. And if you watch people that they don't know necessarily how to ride a horse, here's what they'll do. They'll be yelling at the horse to stop. Whoa, whoa. They're pulling back on the reins yelling. The horse takes the yelling for go, go. And they're saying, whoa, whoa. They get hurt when they don't give that horse his head. Because he gets all out of whack. You give that horse his head, you're safe. Folks, give the Holy Spirit his head. Let him do what he wants to do in your life. When you come to church, be ready. Bring your running shoes. Bring your dancing shoes. Bring your shouting shoes, singing shoes. Bring your sweating shoes. Amen. Let him have his way. Well, Pastor, that sounds like pandemonium. It's not pandemonium. It's the letting the Holy Spirit move. I keep telling you this. If you're going to be a body that allows the moving of the Holy Spirit, you got to be prepared for a little bit of excess and a little bit of wildfire. But I'd rather have excess and wildfire than nothing and a bunch of wet blankets. Because at least when there's wildfire, something's getting hot. Amen. Do you see that? Hallelujah. So there's going to be times somebody gives a word and they're going to miss it. Well, what are we going to do? Well, we'll just correct it. This is where you can train and be safe. Isn't that good? Whew. Tell your neighbor, say, give the Holy Spirit his head. Now, we're going to teach on some things tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now, I really feel, gentlemen, we probably need to receive the offering after this message. Because we're going to deal with the subject of increase. Now, I've been telling you over the last few years, I remember Pastor Michelle, the Lord dealt with both of us about this because she was coming back from Little Rock. And the Lord was asking us to do different things and to push into TCT and Total Christian Television and go on other networks. And she asked the Lord, she said, Lord, how are we going to do this? And the Lord said this to her. He said, well, you have to increase. And then a few months later, I was praying about some things the Lord wanted us to do. And I asked the same question. I said, Lord, how are we going to do this? I mean, I'm willing. I'm ready. I'm available to what you're asking me to do, but how are we going to do this? And he said the same words to me. He said, you have to increase. See, God doesn't have one answer for you and another answer for me. If you go to God and you say, how am I going to do this? He'll tell you, you have to increase. Now, when we talk about increase, preachers are real quick to qualify it. And here's what they do. Now, we're not just talking about money. Well, right then, that tells me that he's afraid to talk about prosperity. Because if you've been coming here any length of time, you know that we're not just talking about money. But here's the thing. If you're going to prosper, money's involved.
Amen.
Amen. For God to increase us the way that he wants to, we've got to allow him. Say out loud, I must increase.
I must increase.
Amen.
Amen.
Do you see that? Now, why must we increase? Well, you've got to increase because there are going to be things that God asks you to do. And when God asks you to do it, you want to be in a position to do it.
Amen.
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 Another reason you have to increase is so you can bless your family.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Remember what I told you over and over again? God doesn't mind you driving the best, living in the best, having the best. But the thing is, he said, I've given you all things richly to enjoy. I enjoy things. I don't love things. I enjoy things. You never love money and use God. You use money and love God.
Amen.
Amen. Do you see that? Now, I am going to go back and we're going to look at some of the same scriptures that Pastor Michelle taught on Wednesday night. And you got to understand, my wife and I, we flow in the like anointing. And remember Faith Explosion? I just took the message she preached the night before and re-preached it. And it came out totally different. Amen. Why? Because God, we co-pastor these churches. And what God is speaking through her, he's speaking to you. And what he's speaking through me, he's speaking to you. And so we can look at these things and get a revelation here.
Amen.
Amen. See, the enemy wants you to over-obligate yourself financially so he can limit what you can do to the kingdom.
Correct.
What you can limit in the kingdom. So he can limit what you can give into the kingdom. You understand? That's important. He wants you to over-obligate yourself so that he can limit what you're able to do in the kingdom. When I got that revelation, a lot of things changed in my life. You're not going to limit me in what I can do in the kingdom. Hallelujah. Do you see that? I got tired of making a choice between this bill and sowing. And sometimes it was a bill for something I didn't even need. Amen. Now let's look here. Say this out loud. The Lord
wants to fully supply
with over and above.
Say
the Lord
wants to fully supply
with over and above. Hallelujah. Now you may be here and you say, well, Pastor, I got enough for me and my family. Well, then you don't have enough. Because the Bible says in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 through 3, the Lord told Abraham seven different things he was going to do for him. Sevenfold blessing. I taught on that at men's meeting. A sevenfold blessing that was attached there. And one of those things was that Abraham would be a channel of increase and blessing. We often say blessed to be a blessing. Every man of faith is to be a center of blessing and increase.
Amen. Amen.
I'll say it here too. Every man of faith or woman is to be a center of blessing and increase.
Amen.
Every man or woman of faith is to be a center of blessing and increase.
Amen.
Hallelujah. See, that's a good place to say that happens to me all the time. Now, in Luke chapter 5 is where we want to begin. I woke up this morning with this in my spirit. I woke up with the Lord saying this to me. The time for increase is now.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Luke chapter 5 and verse 1. And I'll qualify that by saying, now that's financial increase, but that's increase in your health. That's increase in your family. That's increase in your ability to do what God wants you to do. Increase in the anointing. Luke chapter 5 verse 1. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed or asked him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all night. We have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the nets, or I will let down the net. King James says net, the Greek says nets. I will let down the net. And when they had this done, well, what is the this that they had done? Let down the net. See, there's abundance and increase, but it will always be accessed by following an instruction. Increase is wrapped in obedience. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net broke. And they beckoned to their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come. And they came and filled both the ships, so they began to sink. Now notice something. He tells Simon, let down your nets for a catch. And Simon is shortage focused. We have toiled all night and we have nothing to show for our labor. We have toiled all night and we have nothing to show for it. Amen. Well, Pastor, I've heard that before. Yeah, but you never get full faith from one hearing.
Amen.
You never get full faith from one hearing. Jesus is saying, let down your nets for a catch. Now, I don't know what they knew about Jesus. I don't know. But here's what I know. Jesus is saying to do this. And Simon's response was, yeah, but we've toiled all night. And we have nothing Well, Pastor, what's that akin to? Well, I've been given and I don't see anything. I've been doing everything I know to do and I still don't see any results. But that shows me where the focus is. It's not on the sowing, it's on the shortage. What was it going to cost him to let down a net? I mean, he already worked all night and got nothing. Watch, 5 more minutes of nothing. Right? Do you see that? But he's shortage focused. Think, see, be. Those never change. What you think on is what you're going to see, and that's what you're going to be. If you are shortage focused, you're going to have a lot of shortage. And the Bible says toil does not increase wealth.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Are you following me? So Simon is shortage focused. God keeps telling us, you're going to increase. This is the year of favor and light. You're going to increase. So our focus should be on increase.
Amen.
On walking in favor and light.
Amen.
Amen. Do you see that?
Yes.
Yeah, but I'm facing this challenge and I'm facing that challenge and I'm facing this other thing. I understand that. But the key again is you don't focus on the challenge in the challenge. You focus on the promise in the challenge.
Amen.
Do you see that?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Don't ever, never be that person that says, but I'm giving and nothing's working. I've sowed and I haven't seen anything. Wait a minute. Did you sow? I did. I sowed. The Bible says that when you sow, you reap.
Yes.
Right?
Amen.
What does a farmer do if he has a less than bumper crop 1 year? Sow again. Why? Because it works. That's a law. Do you see what I'm saying? Now he was shortage focused. But when he did what Jesus said, they needed help with the harvest. Both boats were filled with a supernatural supply. And guess what? It did not originate from human effort or reasoning.
Amen.
One of the things you got to remember about sowing and reaping is it is supernatural.
Amen.
Amen. It's supernatural. That's why the devil fights this so hard. Amen. Do you see that? This supernatural supply did not originate with human effort or reasoning. It made no sense to Peter to go let down the nets. No sense to go do that. But he said, at your word, I'll do it. And when he had done it, he enclosed a great number of fishes, so many fish that it took 2 boats to pull them in and it almost sunk both boats. That's increase now. I say that's increase.
Amen.
Amen. Now, look here at John 10:10. We're just talking on increase tonight. Just talking on increase.
Hallelujah.
John chapter 10, verse 10. The thief cometh not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life. They might have it more abundantly. The Amplified Bible says, to the full, till it overflows. He wants us to have and enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full until it overflows. Hallelujah. See, this abundant life should flow every day. And when it flows, here's what it should do. Move me into more abundance.
Amen.
It moves me into more increase.
Yes.
Because this abundant life is flowing. Hallelujah. He said, I am come that you might have and enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full until it overflows. Folks, if you believe increase, you declare increase, and you sow for increase, you will increase.
Amen.
But where does it start? Believe increase. This abundant life flows to the people that believe in it. I can tell you why the word works for some people and doesn't work for others. Them that it works for, they believe it. They believe what it says. So you believe increase. You declare increase. What? So what do you do when you see lack? Declare what?
Increase.
Declare abundance. Amen. Do you see that? What do you do when there are symptoms in your body? Declare healing. Amen. You don't agree with the symptom. You don't deny it, but you don't agree with it. Why? That's not abundant life. That's not life to the full until it overflows. Amen. That's not enjoying life. I'm just going to preach this the way the Bible says it. Those days of struggling to meet your bills and struggling to get by, that's not abundant life. That's not having life to the full. That's not enjoying life.
Amen.
Do you see that?
Yes.
So this abundant life should flow every day and move me towards more increase.
Amen.
I got to believe it, declare it, and sow towards it. In Proverbs 11, I talked some on this scripture today, but I'm going to take you back over here. Because this is one of those scriptures that we know. Let me say something here about giving. Is this all right? If God tells you to give it, then it must be on the way. Well, God's been dealing with me to sow this seed, but I don't have it. Then it must be on the way. Amen.
Amen.
That's how you never miss an opportunity to give. When God tells you to give it, even if you don't have it, you release your faith for it, and it's on the way.
Amen.
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 I've been asking the Lord recently for more opportunities to sow. Father, give me more direction about where to sow and who to sow. The Lord gave me those three things I told you today in prayer meeting. When God tells you to sow a seed, the first thing deals with you about sowing a seed, the first thing you ask is how much? Where, number two, do I sow it? Or number three, who do I sow it to? Do I sow it to a ministry? Do I sow it to a person? And how much do I need to sow? Well, what if he tells me an amount I don't have? He tells you an amount you don't have, it's on the way.
Amen.
Are you following me?
Yes.
Folks, listen, this is how I live my life. This is how I live my life.
Amen.
Every time a piece of money comes into my life, I say, okay, Lord, is this mine or do I give it to somebody else? Now, I'm not just saying that cliche, and don't you just go out there and do that because I do it. You got to work your faith with this thing. increase will come to you on the basis of your faith in God's ability to increase you.
Amen.
Increase does not come to you just because you're at Faith Builders. Increase comes to you because you believe and have faith for increase to flow in your life. Do you see that? Say out loud, I have faith for increase to flow in my life. Do you see that? So if God says, give it, sow it, it must be coming. See, that stops you from ever, listen. Don't ever allow money to tell you that you cannot sow. Don't ever let money tell you you can't sow. And here's why. I'm going to read a verse in a minute. Because you'll get over there and get into carnality. Carnal people will never increase. And the reason they will never increase is natural circumstances always dictate to them what they're able to do. Do you hear me? When the Lord asked me three different times to sow my whole check, you know what He was doing? He was getting me out of a carnal way of thinking. He asked me to do that before He told me to step off my job. I'm not telling you He'll ask you to do that. But when He asked me for my check, He was proving something to me. I don't need a check to take care of you.
Amen.
I don't need your job to bless you. Now that don't mean go quit your job.
Right.
It means He's telling me, I don't need that to bless you. And every time we did that, we never missed anything. We never lacked any groceries. We never lacked any ability to do what we needed to do. God was bringing something to pass in our lives. And when it come around in January of 1999, and He said, now February 22nd, 1999 is your last day on your job. It never crossed my mind that I was taking a severe cut in pay to come pastor this church. Never crossed my mind. Why? Because the biggest thing on my mind was I've already given my check away before and God took care of me. Don't you ever let money tell you what you can sow and what you can't sow. You can sow anything God tells you to sow. Amen.
Amen.
You can always do what God tells you to do.
Amen.
You can always sow what God tells you to sow. Hallelujah. Do you see that? You'll be sitting there and God will say, well, I want you to pay so-and-so's car payment. Well, Lord, I don't even know how much it is. Well, go find out. Well, what if it's a bunch? Well, then God, it's on the way. I mean, don't go tell him, now the Lord told me to pay your car payment. Go find out how much it is. Release your faith for it, and when it comes in, pay their car note.
Amen.
Well, why would the Lord have me to do that? Well, why are you blessed? Every man of faith should be a center of blessing and increase.
Amen.
Do you see that? I was pulling into our parking lot the other day. And the Lord said to me, He said, find out how much your daughter's car note is and pay it. Okay. So I found out. And she said, and she was raised in this and she knows we sow and give. But she said, well, Dad, why are you doing this? I said, I just want to be a blessing. Oh, well, thank you. No special reason. Just be a blessing. Amen. Now do you understand? Now look, I'm not going to qualify this by saying I'm not bragging. If you think I'm bragging, you got a wrong spirit. I'm not bragging. I had it. God said, give it, and I had it. Now there are things, I didn't have to pray about it. I didn't have to believe for it. I had it. There are seeds that God asked me and my wife the other day to sow a seed. Now we're having to faith that thing in. Oh, but it's coming.
Amen.
And the person God told us to sow it to, they are going to go wild.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise.
Why? Increase. 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 Are you following me? And I live with a hound dog. She just won't leave me alone about that increase. We're going to increase. Amen. Do you hear what I'm trying to say? But don't let money tell you you can't. Money is your servant, not your master. Right, see, now say that out loud. Say, money is my servant, not my master. Do you hear me? So that means money doesn't tell you what to do. Now, I'm not telling you to go out there and overspend and do a bunch of stuff in the flesh. You remember, you got to be in faith about this. Amen. Hallelujah. So you got to refuse to struggle with giving. You got to refuse to struggle with giving. You know, we all tell the story and we all laugh about Jim saying he used to leave his wallet in the car. Because he figured if he came in here and I preached on money, he could literally say truthfully that he didn't have his wallet with him. I mean, that's just a partial lie. You know, it's out in the car. So you brought it. It's just in the car, biggin. Amen. Right? Well, now he's mature enough for me to preach this about him. What was the problem? He had a problem with giving. There are other people in here, you have the exact opposite problem. You have a problem with receiving. Because you have the mindset, well, my needs are met and I really don't need anything else. You got a problem with receiving. And if somebody came up and tried to bless you, you'd say, oh, no, I don't need that. I got everything I need. Take the money. Focus, Otis. Take the money. Amen. Amen. Yeah, but I really don't need it. Take it and ask God, do I need to give this to somebody else? God's trying to get you used to being a channel for blessing. Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. Do you see that? Yes. Amen. I like knowing that people watch you seeing if you're going to bless them. I like that. I intend to be the channel. Amen. You're going to have to sneak around and sneak under the table and go get the server by theirself before we ever start eating if you're going to pay for my meal. Because I want to be the channel of blessing. I want to have so many meal tickets to my credit that I will never ever go without. I'll never lack anything. Why? Because I want to be happy, hilarious, prompt to do it, giver. I want to be a center of blessing and increase. Hallelujah. Do you see that? I say, do you see that? I'll be out to eat with ministers and I'll say, y'all excuse me for a minute. I'll go to the men's room because I'm not going to lie. Go wash my hands or something. And then I'll find the servant and I'll say, here you go. Be sure and put this on me. And then it's so funny to see all them preachers that are trying to get the check. And then they bring it back and it's just the receipt. Here you go. Ha ha ha. Psych. Amen. Center of blessing and increase. Am I helping you with this? So you refuse to struggle with giving. Don't put that pressure on yourself. Well, God's asking me to do this, and how am I going to do it? Just hang on. If He said to give it, it's on the way. Now, in Proverbs 11, you found it? Verse 24, there is that scattereth, there is that scattereth, and yet increaseth. And there is that withholdeth more than his meat, but it tends to poverty. The liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that waters shall be watered also himself. Now, when you withhold, you produce in your life the thing you're trying to prevent. See, that's getting over there in the carnal nature. Well, Lord, I mean, I could give that $20 in my pocket, but Lord, that's the last 20 I got, and that's got to last me all week. So you'd rather subsist on the last 20 you got than give it to God who said, I'll multiply seed sown? So you got over in the carnal mind and you actually produced what you're trying to prevent. That's not abundant thinking. Do you see that? Hallelujah. Being a generous giver will ensure abundance. You know, generosity does not necessarily mean that you're given a huge chunk. It's you're generous with what you have.
Amen.
And then the amounts get bigger. You know, the Lord has said to us over and over again, he said, keep making your plans, keep going after your vision, and he said, just give me some time and I'll bring it all to pass. He said through Mrs. Harrison, he said it twice. He said, let me read it word for word. I don't want to misquote the Holy Spirit. He said this, he said, hallelujah. I got it right here. I keep hearing this. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Emphasis. It's around the corner, just on time. Around the corner, just on time. He said, just sit tight, hold steady, and know the time's close. Yeah, but what about what it's going to cost? That's not what he said to focus on. He said, just know the time is close. Sit tight, hold steady, sit tight, hold steady. It's around the corner just on time. Around the corner. Well, what's around the corner just on time? The provision for everything he said we're going to need. Do you see this? So for increase to come, there has to be a sitting tight and knowing God's going to do what he said he was going to do.
Glory.
But when the opportunity comes, listen, I saw, you know, Brother Copeland he believed for that first Citation 10, $23 million. And God, there are people in our church and in our fellowship that sowed into that Citation 10 project, $23 million. Well, then God said, I need you to press into another one so that this team can go all different directions. Now, there are people that have a problem with a preacher owning a jet, and I say shame on them. But amen, because they don't mind that all these sinners have a jet. It doesn't bother them at all. That it doesn't bother them at all that the KU basketball team has their own charter jet to go play a stupid game. Amen. Matter of fact, we all buy their merchandise and line their pockets. Rock chalk. Right? What do you mean that preacher's got a plane? $23 million for a plane? But you don't mind paying Bill Self that much to coach a ball team? Where's your priorities? It's okay to spend that money on the fuel to put it in a private jet to fly our basketball team to play a game they might not even win. And we'll dog cuss them all the way home because of the game they lost. But now here's a man of God getting people healed and getting people saved and getting people born again and set free. And we got a problem with him having a $23 million jet. But you don't mind the KU basketball team living in $100,000 condominiums. Have you ever thought about that? That basketball team lives two to a apartment. Each of those apartments cost $110,000. And you paid for it. Well, we've got to take care of our athletes. We got to take care of the man of God. So they paid $23 million for that. We had to believe it in. Well, then the Lord said, I need you to believe for this second one. Cessna called them and said, we want to give you a heck of a deal. We'll give you this second plane for $17 million. Yeah, but Pastor, that's not much difference. Well, it's not much difference till you start paying millions for something. $22.9 million would have been a big discount. Amen. But here's the point. Now listen, here's the point that I want to make to you. Here's the point that I want to make to you. And he stepped up and he said, I told him, okay. Now wait a minute. He didn't have $17 million in the bank. See, sometimes we think, here's what we think. Oh, well, Brother Copeland's got that just laying around. I've had people come up to me and say, no, Pastor, I know you don't struggle with this kind of stuff. You know, God asks you to do things and you just go do it. No, wait a minute. Where'd you hear that? You didn't hear that from me. Everything I get, I got to faith it in just like you got to faith it in. Faith is the rope that goes into the unseen realm and pulls out of the spirit realm what you need into the physical realm. And everybody in here has the same rope of faith, and you got to extend it just like I've got to extend mine to get increase into your life. Amen. 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 Now, I'm telling you that story for a reason. So he said, okay. He did not let the number $17 million intimidate him. It's got to be done. I say it's got to be done. Now, how do I know it's going to happen? Well, number one, I know it's going to happen because the man's given away 27 airplanes. 27 airplanes. Tony, planes. You know how much the plane we're believing for costs. He's given 27 of them things away. So there's planes in the ground. That means there'll be another Citation 10 in the sky. Proclaiming the word of faith from the top of the world to the bottom and all the way around it. Bringing believers from the milk of the word to the meat of the word and teaching them how to walk victorious by the word of God. Amen. I don't know if I like him. Well, he's my partner, so don't you talk about him. Amen. Amen. I'm a partaker of that anointing. Amen. Hallelujah. So, do you see what I'm saying? Being a generous giver ensures abundance. I desire to fund what God is doing. I want to fund what God is doing. I want to be such a center of blessing and increase that when somebody's upgrading their AV or upgrading their cameras, I can say, look, I'll pay for two of them. I'll pay for the control center. I'll pay for this. I'll pay for that. Well, Pastor, what's that? Why? Because the gospel's going out over that thing. That is Peter's boat. When you sow into a project in this church, that's Peter's boat. That studio project that we're believing God for and that we're seeing rapidly come to fruition, that's Peter's boat. boat. Every time the gospel's going out over these airwaves and over the internet, and then we take these programs and we put them on our television program, every time we do that, somebody's going to hear the word. Somebody's going to get healed. Somebody's going to get set free. Somebody's going to hear something that's going to revolutionize their life. And you made it possible by increasing and being generous. Hallelujah. Never again say, when's it going to come in? It's on the way right now. Amen. Am I helping you? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, you know, Pastor, I just think there's more to it than money. And listen, preachers spend so much time qualifying themselves. They sound like they're almost apologetic for teaching people that God wants to bless them. I make no apologies for it. I tell you all the time to say out loud, God wants you fully supplied, completely filled, rich, rich, rich.
Amen.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
I don't apologize for that. Why? I've been broke and rich is better.
Amen.
I've been sick and well is better.
Yeah.
I've been depressed and joyful is better.
Amen.
I've been without and with is better.
Amen.
Amen. I've been hungry and filled is better.
Amen.
I have been poorly clothed and well clothed is better.
Amen.
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 No apologies. God wants you to increase.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Let me hurry. I desire to fund, say it out loud, I desire to fund what God is doing.
I desire to fund what God is doing.
Look at 2 Corinthians 9. Hallelujah. 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 I'll tell you, we keep looking for avenues to sow seed. Pastor Caldwell had a 36 series that he had taught at his church called at Agape, called the Overcomers Library. 36 Wednesdays he taught on overcoming. And I had talked to him for a number of years, a couple years about it. And I said, you know, I would like to take those CDs and put some series together out of them, because he has a lot of messages in there that really go good together. And I've listened to all of those. And so here recently, we took 16 of those. Is it 16, Jim, or 11? 18. We took 18 of those and downloaded them all. And we're doing the same thing that we did with No More Limits and Acting and Thinking Like Jesus and the Character of Christ. We're putting them on USB. All right. So it's Overcomers Library number one. Now then we'll come back and do Overcomers Library number two. Now I'm telling you this for a reason. So the Lord dealt with me to do that. Now the Lord dealt with us to do that and to finance that, to take care of that. So that's what we do. But then he dealt with me about getting some touch cards put together. So when we're working his media table, we have that information about Happy Caldwell Ministries and VTN. Amen. And so Ron over here, our resident graphic artist, amen, he put that thing together, and I took it to the HCM board meeting. I'm on the board of Pastor Caldwell's ministry, and I took it there and showed it to him, and they were just so pleased. So pleased with it. Well, then we just ordered them, and we ordered them. They came in the other day, stack of them like this, and we get to debut them in May at the FCF conference. But here's the point, and there's other things God's asked us to do. Why is God asking us to do that? So we can increase.
Amen.
I've told you a couple times now how that this ministry and seeds we've sown and things that we've done, we helped pay off all the debt at Deeper Life Christian Ministries. Amen. I remember preaching there on a Sunday night, Friday night. And the Lord telling me, he said, tell them, we are going to pay this property off. We're going to pay it off. Now, I'm not taking credit for it, but I knew immediately, okay, now I got to get busy sowing into this. Because this is what we're going to do. I desire to fund what God is doing. I desire to fund what God is doing. And however I can make it happen, and I'm not going to allow money to tell me I can't. Money's a poor master. Hallelujah. See, money works against you. When money becomes your master, it works against you. It's deceptive. Money's deceptive. Here's why. Because you got a pocket full of money, you think you're doing okay. You have no money in your pocket, you think you're doing bad. Well, you're deceived. I say you're deceived. Amen. But I don't have any money. How can you say I'm doing good? Do you have seed in the ground? Well, yeah. Well, there you go. You live on your seed, not what's in your pocket. Amen. It's deceptive. Money will turn on you. When money's your master, it'll turn on you. When money's your master, you'll work every hour they'll give you at the expense of your relationship with God, at the expense of your family, at the expense of your health. Well, I'm just doing it because, you know, you're doing it for the money. Money is now your master. It's the person that says, if God can't supply my needs on 40 hours a week, then he can't supply my needs, period. I'm not saying God won't use overtime to bless you, but it's not going to destroy you. Oh, glory. Let me move on. Amen. Do you see that? 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 8. No, I'm not done there. Money is a poor master.
Amen.
Money has its knee in people's back.
Yes, sir.
They can't do this because of the money. They're struggling with this because of the money. I can't because of the money. I can't do this because of the money. I'd like to do that, but I can't because of the money. Money's running things. And people will say it's the lack of money. No, it's money. It's money. Money is running the thing.
Amen.
Well, how do I break free from that? You make God your source. God, supply, and need. God is the total source of my supply. Say it out loud. God is the total source of my supply. Say it out loud. Say, I'm abundantly supplied.
I'm abundantly
completely
filled.
Rich, rich, rich. God is the total source of my supply.
God is the total source of my supply.
That's shouting ground.
Amen.
But God blessed me with this job. Yes, he did. For you to be a blessing and for that job to be a blessing to you. When your job ceases being a blessing and becomes labor, something's wrong. Because my job is one of those all things that God gave me richly to enjoy. When it becomes labor and it becomes toil and it becomes effort that you hate, something's wrong. And usually it's a wrong relationship with money. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 9 verse 8. Am I done there, Lord? I think I'm done. Amen. All right. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may abound unto every good work. Hallelujah. See, people are concerned about money, and I don't want to be disobedient. Disobedience is asking for a wrong thing. Here's what I mean. You'll hear people say this. And they say it, and I know what they mean. And before the Lord corrected me, I've even said it before. Here's what they'll say. Well, you seek the giver and not the gift. Where's that at in the Bible? Well, it says seek first the kingdom of God, and all these, right, and all these things would be added to you. Pastor Michelle used this illustration. I'll use it again because it was so good. I have Pastor Tony Paul on here in the front row, been with us for all these years. You know, Pastor Paula needed $50. And she comes over to Brother Charles and says, Brother Charles, I need $50. And Pastor Tony finds out about that. You know what he's going to say? Why didn't you ask me? I'm your husband. I mean, I love Charles, but you don't be asking Charles for no money. I'm your husband. Isn't that about how it would go? I mean, that's how it would be for me. God doesn't want you going to somebody else for what you need. He wants you to come ask Him. If you're not seeking the gift, why are you going to Him? If you're not interested in the thing, why are you going to God? Well, I'm not seeking the gift, I'm seeking the giver. Then why are you asking for the gift? You're either fibbing or you're seeking the gift. You're seeking the gift. But who are you seeking the gift from? The God that you love. The God that loves you. Don't fall into that religious way of thinking. That'll kill you financially. Amen. Amen. Who does every good and every perfect gift come down from? So if you're going to get every good and perfect gift, what do you have to do? Go to God. And what do you got to do? Ask for every good and every perfect gift. And one of the gifts he talked about was wisdom. He said, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it will be given to him. That's one of those fill in the blank scriptures. If any of you lack prosperity, let him ask. The Amplified says, the giving God. And he'll give it to him. And he gives without reservation. It's unreservedly. Amen. See, this abound, it means to exceed a fixed number or a measure. To be left over and above a certain number or a measure. A thing which comes in abundance or overflows. To furnish one so richly so that he has abundance. Or to superabound. Shall I read that again? Yes. Abound, it means to exceed a fixed number or measure. To be left over and above a certain number or a measure. A thing which comes in abundance or overflows. To furnish one so richly so that he has abundance. Superabound. That's his desire. Do you see that? Now we know, and we'll say this is not limited to money. But he wants you so full that you abound to good works. Amen. This is fully supplied. In what? All spiritual, mental, emotional, physical, relational, and etc. This is my family provision. In everything you need. This is provision. I was praying about something one time. If you give me 10 minutes, I'll be done here. I was praying about something. A certain thing that was coming up. And the Lord asked me, he said, Philip, or he didn't ask me, he told me. He said, that didn't catch me off guard. You realize the problem a lot of people have when they sin? They think that when they sin or when they confess it is when God found out about it. God knew about it when you did it. Amen. My confession of that sin is what brought the removal of it. God did not find out about the need when you told him about it. God anticipates every possible scenario and makes provision for it.
Amen.
Amen. Do you see that? Folks, I've been preaching this. I found one of the first series that I taught on a Friday night here in this church 19 years ago was the laws of prosperity. I've been studying this subject for over 20 years. I'm telling you something. I don't know much yet, but I've learned a lot more. That provision will always be there. Amen.
Amen.
Do you see that? This is what he desires to do. For me to superabound. But what do I have to do? I've got to believe increase, declare increase, and sow for increase. That never changes. Hallelujah. Do you see that? Now, hallelujah. Let me tell you this story, and I've told you before, but as Yolanda says, pastors have stories. Amen. Now, that's what she said, I say, and I do say that. I've told you this story about I came home from work, and my parents were in town, and we were living, I believe we were living in Kansas City, Kansas at the time, over off of Parallel, 78th and State. And in any event, my car needed an oil change. No, I'm sorry, we were living in Missouri because I still had that old blue station wagon. My car needed an oil change. I didn't have the money to get my oil changed. And my dad was there, him and mom were off the evangelistic field. He gave me $20 to get an oil change. And we went to church that night. It was a Friday night, and we went to church, and my mom went with me, and Pastor Morton was ministering. For whatever reason, that night I didn't sit on the front row. That was highly unusual. I think I was running late, probably because my sister was with us. Amen. And any event, we got there, and we had to sit in the middle section, you know, back about where Anthony's at, where the backsliders sit. And, oh, wait a minute. Wait, hallelujah. Love you, son. Praise God. Now, I'm joking. I'm joking. But here's the point. They received the offering, and then Pastor Morton did something. He didn't do this. I think I've seen him do it twice, maybe. And he said, the Lord is dealing with me, this after he ministered, to receive another offering. And he said, there's an anointing here tonight. And remember, there's not a debt-busting anointing or something like that. Jesus said the anointing, or Isaiah said the anointing removes the burden and destroys the yoke. So, I mean, I understand what people mean when they say that, but you can't look in the Bible and find a debt-busting anointing. But there is an anointing that you sow into, all right, that's present, all right? There's a certain time to sow corn, and there's a certain time to sow wheat, and there are certain times that it's time to sow. Amen. And that's what he said. He said, I feel like this is the time to sow. And man, I'm standing there, and have you ever had that money in your pocket start burning a hole in your pocket? Because you know you're supposed to give it. Well, I needed an oil change. I mean, that's how my wife got around. I rode the bus to work. That's how she got around. Amen. But you know what? I learned a long time ago, the time to sow the seed is when God deals with you to sow the seed. Right? Have you ever done anything and you just couldn't think about it because you knew if you thought about it, you wouldn't do it? Man, I just reached in my pocket. Probably looked like a guy with ants in my pants. I just jumped in my pocket and run up there and put that money in the offering. Boy, I turned around and came back, and I had a family member there with me, and boy, they gave me the stink eye. Because they knew I didn't have no money. They knew why that had been given to me. That was the beginning of the I don't care ministry in my life. See, folks, I'm telling you something that I hope you're getting the gravity of. I didn't have anything. I had shoes so bad that my wife told me, she said, Philip, please, when you pray with people at the altar, baby, don't kneel anymore, squat. I said, why? She said, because everybody can see the holes in your shoes. I had one suit. My wife bought it at Salvation Army for $1.75 for our anniversary. I had one white shirt that my wife cleaned and sent to the cleaners. One white shirt. We didn't have anything. I'm not joking. We had nothing. We were living in an apartment that I wouldn't... Listen, I love my enemies, so of course I wouldn't put them there. I wouldn't put anybody there. Amen. We didn't have anything. We were broke. I was working every hour they would give me, and we had nothing. I walked to the mailbox every 2 weeks and got my food stamps. You hear me? That we didn't have the EBT card. We had to use the stamps. We had the book. Well, Pastor, you was on welfare? Yes, sir. Working every hour they would give me. My wife was working every hour they would give us. Cleaning apartments. Yeah, my wife. Vacuuming out those breezeways. Went over there to the Daisy Walnut Apartments one day. Worked all day long. Worked all day long on those breezeways. Worked hard. Worked all day long from morning till she had to go get the kids. Went to get her check and they said, "We're not going to pay you. We don't like the job you did." Went into business with a family member. And the family member would decided that they should, all the businesses should make all the checks out to us, to my wife. Not to the two of them, to my wife. Guess what she did at the end of the year? Stuck us with all the taxes. See, no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't get ahead. I would just get one foot forward and something would happen. I decided that night, I'm ending this. I didn't have nothing. Amen. And I walked up there and gave that $20. Folks, I'm telling you something. I can trace my financial freedom back to a $20 seed. I know the DNA of my prosperity. It started in the Deeper Life Christian Ministries ground with a $20 seed that I couldn't afford to sow. Because I didn't have nothing. Y'all remember that drink Slim Fast when it was, you know, powder? You know what I took for lunch? Slim Fast. And it wasn't because I was slimming and fasting. It was that was cheap. Amen. I know what it's like to go in the cabinet and find some beanie weenies. And you don't even care what the expiration date is. I ate so much of that paper-thin Carl Budding ham. My Lord. Amen. I'm trying to explain to you. I know what it's like. I've been broke. I've been poor. I didn't have nothing. And God began to get these principles into my life. That this works.
Amen.
Amen. And I sowed that $20 seed. Now, I can't tell you about a miraculous harvest that came because of that $20 seed. But I can tell you I learned something. I learned that I've got to act in faith. If I'm going to change this, I've got to act in faith. And then it wasn't long after that, God put us in touch with the ministry of Charles Capps. And he began to teach us that we can have what we say. Amen. And we started watching our words. And we quit saying we're broke and we don't have and why is everything going wrong? And we started changing our words. And I'm telling you what, we got a considerable amount of relief just by changing what we say. And then God, we moved over to Kansas City, Kansas, over off 78th and State. And I got a hold of the 1998 Prosperity Convention at World Changers Church. Dr. Creflo Dollar, Dr. Leroy Thompson, and John Avanzini. A man there preaching the word on finances. And you remember the story. I'm sitting there in the house and Dr. Thompson is preaching about not being broke another day in your life. And he made that statement, "I'll never be broke another day in my life." And man, that hit me in my spirit. And I jumped up and started running around that little house. It didn't take much. It wasn't but as big as from here to Amy and them. And we was just running. That's the kitchen and the living room. And we're just running around. Me and my wife screaming, I'll never be broke another day in my life. And the kids got up, what's going on? They saw us running. They just started running. Woo! You know, Pentecostal kids, if you're running, they run. I mean, Ronnie, right now, somebody starts running, he just takes off. Amen. Hallelujah. You can't help it. You're raised Pentecostal. Somebody squalls, you squall. Woo! Woo! You just do it. Amen. That's fun to preach in those kind of churches because you go, and they go, they all go, hey, anyway. Hallelujah. Yeah, there you go. Hallelujah. Glory to God. They really did start running. I mean, I don't know if it's because they're Pentecostal or not, but something broke. Wasn't too long after that, God asked me to sew my whole check. I'd never sowed a seed like that. But the whole time, listen, the whole time I'm listening to the word on prosperity. I'm listening to the word on coming and being free. I'm at work. Pastor Michelle will record programs, Believer's Voice of Victory, World Changers, different programs. I come home. I didn't flip on Sports Center. I didn't flip on anything else. I went down in the basement where she had my father's ministry office set. She was his secretary, his assistant at the time. They had TV down there, VCR. I'd go down there, pop in that tape, and watch that in the evening. And just get in the Word of God. This is what God said. And God began to give me a revelation of seed time and harvest. The church I was assistant pastor at, I taught somewhere in the neighborhood of 12 or 8 weeks on seed time and harvest. It was so real in people that I had farmers in that church. And they brought seed bags full of seed corn and put them at the altar as an illustration. And man, that people started getting blessed. People started getting a hold of the Word of God. God started bringing us out. Things improved. Now listen, that took years to go from having nothing to breaking even. But folks, listen. I'm 20 years on the other side of that now. You hear me? And I'm just going to tell you something. God has been good to Philip. Amen. But here's the thing. I'm like Abraham. I can stand before you tonight and tell you something. Nobody made me rich. God did this.
Amen.
Well, Pastor, you rich? Yes, sir. Fully supplied. Amen. It's the blessing. Folks, I went years and didn't take a raise at this church. You hear me? The board recently, the last 2 years, voted to increase the amount of money I get. But here's why. To help compensate for insurance for the family. It doesn't go in my pocket. It goes for something. God is the total source of my supply. Listen to me. You take everything I got. You take everything away from me that I have and leave me my Bible and I'll get it all back.
Amen.
Because this is how I got it in the first place. Amen. I didn't get it through Amway. I didn't get it through Shackley. I didn't get it through a pyramid scheme. I got it through the Word of God.
Amen. Amen.
And I'm not going back. We're increasing more and more. Say out loud, I'm increasing more and more. Say it again, I'm increasing more and more. Say this, I have houses. Full of all good things.
Full of all
pleasant
and precious riches.
I have all I need.
I'm completely supplied.
Completely filled. Rich, rich, rich. Hallelujah. God's raising up millionaires.
Huh?
Hallelujah. I believe God. Let's get ready to sow tonight. Hallelujah. If you would like to sow, the ushers will be in the aisle. They'll get you an envelope. You can sow into the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. You know, there's a reason the Bible says don't be weary in well-doing. Because there's always the challenge. I remember years ago, John Avanzini wrote a book. I've got the book in my office. The pages are kind of yellow and tattered. But he wrote a book called It's Not Working, Brother John. Because you hear that so much. Well, it's not working. I tried that, but it's not working. And you know, a lot of preachers say, well, that's your problem. You're trying it. Well, if you don't try it, you'll never know. So I don't say that. But folks, that can't be your mindset. I'm trying it. No, this is, listen, how would you wives feel if when you got married, you're talking about being together for the rest of your life and your husband goes, well, we're going to try it. Kim, where you at? Poop, right? Yeah, that's how it would be. Right? No, we're not trying this. We're married. You stuck with me. Amen. Somebody said, what do you do if your wife ever left you? Get my hat and follow her. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Like the old couple, the wife told the old man, they'd been married about 40, 50 years, said, I'm leaving you. And she started walking out the door, and here he came, and she said, well, what are you doing? He said, well, where are we going? Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, you can't leave. You don't try it. You give for a living.
Amen.
Sowing is your way of receiving.
Amen.
So you can't come up here and say, well, I'm going to try this and see if it works. That's not faith. That's presumption. Faith says, I see it in the Word. I'm going to act on the Word. And the Word's going to produce the desired results in my life.
Amen.
Amen? Matter of fact, say that with me. Say,
I'm going to act on the Word.
And the Word is going to produce
the desired results
in my life. Hallelujah. Come on, guys. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Poor devil. He's shaking right now. Hallelujah. The sound of that seed in that seed pouch makes him nervous. Because you're sowing into spiritual ground and he can't do anything about it. Are you ready? When you're ready, just stand on your feet and come rejoicing. Ha ha ha. I believe God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. See, now you got it. Because 2 Corinthians 9 says that by the ministration or the giving, it causes through us thanksgiving to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. By Christmas, you're not going to know your life. Amen. Hallelujah. Shall we stand up tonight? Did you receive anything from the Word? I know you did. That's a bad question. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. If I haven't told you lately, I sure appreciate you. Amen. This is the best church in the world. Hallelujah. That's my totally unbiased opinion. I believe that you're an answer to prayer. Amen. You're an answer to prayer. And this is the best church in the world. And every time, no matter where I go, getting home is my desire. Amen. I have ministers minister here, and to a person, they say, Philip, that church is so deep. And you got to understand what they mean by that. Pastor Michelle was ministering here. When she was here alone, I was in Little Rock. And she said, you know, I told the church, let's all pray in the Holy Ghost. And she said, Philip, at the church in DeSoto, she said, when they started praying in the Holy Ghost, it was a force. You could feel it hit. It was so. Now, I mean, I understand that we've been taught and trained correctly. But here's the point. That speaks a lot about you. You're spiritual people. You can't teach people how to be spiritual. You can show them from the Word of God, then they got to go put it into operation. Amen. And I'll have ministers minister here, and they'll say, your people, when we're ministering, they just pull the Word out of us. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, why? Because you know good food when you see it. Amen. And you don't get that everywhere. There are churches I go to and I go to minister, and it's like, my God, have these people ever heard John 3:16? Keep putting that pressure out there in the Spirit. Keep expecting much and you'll keep receiving much.
Amen.
Amen. I thank God for you. Amen. So, hallelujah. So we got a lot of good things coming up. Obviously, Wednesday night, we've got service here. Pastor Michelle will be ministering. Friday evening. Now, if you're a member of Chariots of Light and you have not yet signed up, we have a sign-up sheet in the back. I think, Greg, is your vest still back there, brother? Back there by the Chariots of Light vest. And we're having a cookout at Rusty and Amy Scheiderly's house. Rusty and Amy, wave your hands. I think everybody knows you, but I want to make sure. Amen. They are right next door, not this house, but the townhouse next door to this home is where they live. We'll be there Friday at 7 o'clock. Amen. Greg is bringing ribs. Pastor Tony is bringing famous macaroni and cheese.
Hallelujah.
All right. I'll be bringing grilled chicken and broccoli. Hallelujah. But no, seriously, sign up for whatever you want to do. If you're interested in Chariots and you would like to see what it's all about, we welcome you to be there because we're going to be doing a lot of good things, and we're going to be talking about the vision that we have for that group and also for setting up some dates to go outreach and do different things. So if you're interested in that, please, you can talk to Greg. You can talk to Cindy if you would like, Greg's wife right here. And just let them know you'd want to come and sign up back there, and we'll have a good time. Amen. Won't keep you late. We'll be there just long enough to do what we need to do, a couple hours, and we'll have you home. But you don't go to the bars anymore, so it don't matter. Amen. Hallelujah. God's good. Amen. Hallelujah. And then, of course, Sunday. Now, this Sunday is Easter Sunday. Now, you know what that means. You need to be an influence to somebody and bring them to church. Everybody will come to church at Easter. Just promise them dinner. They'll come. Amen. Tell them, I'll buy you dinner. You come to church with me. Amen. Yeah, but isn't that a bribe? Yeah, but they might get saved. And money well spent. Praise the Lord. Isn't that good? Amen. Come on, say it out loud with me. The vision of our church will always be to build people's faith and frame their world by the Word of God. You and I will always be world changers. God bless you.